Okay, so good morning, all of you. First of all, I want to know from you all how many of you have started practicing on Word regularly. By regularly, I mean at least two to three sums every day on Word. And I know since this is the CS2 paper, so most of you must be having a hold on your typing skills. So CS2, CM2, the higher classes, we don't really, the higher papers, we don't really concentrate that much on typing. But it is important that you all know that exactly what all things to keep in mind and how to be better at presentation. These are the papers where you can concentrate more on the presentation and be more specific in your answers so that the examiner gets a positive impact on reading your paper. Okay, so today what we will be doing is, first of all, I want to know, is there any problem that any of you faced while solving any questions on Word, any typing issues, any particular topic that you specifically want to practice? Nothing. So in that case, we'll just start today. What we will do is we will be discussing the April 2021 paper. In the previous class, I had shown you my own September 2021 paper, and we had discussed how the actual exam pressure works and then what actually ends up on your answer script. So today, I want you all to maybe practice a little with me. So I have the solution also with me because I don't really want to get into the technicalities. Today we will be focusing mainly on the typing aspect of everything. So CS2 is one paper where IFOA has also given the examiner's report in the keyboard notation form. Till the offline exams were on, the IFOA used to obviously give it in the mathematical notations only. But since it became online, they started giving the examiner's report also in the using the standard keyboard notations. So because of this, we say that it is better if you all can concentrate more on using standard keyboard notations than the equation editor. So just once, we will quickly go through the specifics that are required for the CS2 paper. Multiplication, as I had said, please don't get into the hassle of getting the cross sign by typing times. Simply use an asterisk. No need at all to, definitely don't use X because that is strictly not something you can do. Use an asterisk, nothing else. For division, of course, you have the forward slash. Approximately equal to, even though they have given this option, I would suggest that it's better if you just write approx equal to because it looks better than this, definitely. Again, inequality is very important in the CS2 exam. So these inequalities are fine. You don't have to necessarily put the symbol for the inequalities. You can simply give greater than and equal to or less than and equal to in this form. Proportional to, again, very important. This sign is available in the insert tab, but you can just simply write is proportional to because every time if you go to the insert tab and try to fetch the sign, it will take up a lot of time. Square root is very simple, SQRT. Inside the brackets, you write whatever function or expression there is. Now, superscript and subscript, I will just remind you the shortcuts. For the superscript, it is Control Shift and the plus equal to key. That will automatically go to the superscript. Again, very important thing, as you all saw, as soon as I put the superscript, Word automatically makes every first letter capital when you start a line. So to avoid that, as soon as you see that your letter is becoming capital, you immediately press Control Z. As soon as you press Control Z, which is the shortcut for the undo function, as soon as you press Control Z, it will go back to whatever you had typed. Okay, similarly, one very important thing, after you are done typing everything in the superscript, make sure you press the same keys, Control Shift and the plus equal to key again, so that you come back to the normal alignment. many a times it might happen that you don't realize and you continue typing without realizing, and then later you realize all that you have typed is actually gone into the superscript instead of on the normal alignment. So make sure every time you're pressing the superscript and subscript shortcuts, you go back. Now for the subscript, the shortcut is just the control and plus equal to sign, plus equal to key. So again, same thing, make sure you get back to the normal alignment. Now for subscript, one very common thing which we use in all statistics papers is this, XIJ. There are different things, let's say XI or AI, etc. So what usually happens when we write it on pen, write it using pen and paper, the A and then the I comes in the subscript, right? So because of this, many of us may write it as A underscore I. However, it is allowed that in such cases where the subscript is actually denoting, you know, your repetition letters, I, J, etc., to show that it belongs to a class or it is a continuing variable. In that case, you can simply write AI and skip the underscore. Just like over here, they have skipped the underscore for XIJ, correct? When you show random variables, let's say. So in that case, this comes up. So you can simply write the IJ along with the letter. And of course, if you want, you can use the subscript or you can use the underscore as well. Now exponential, again, I would suggest go for this one. Don't go for e to the power and then write the function or the expression. Prefer this one, exp, and then inside the bracket, you write whatever you want to write, in which was supposed to be e to the power of whatever. Accented symbols, again, they have given two options, b caret sign hat or simply b hat. Now, of course, when you are reading it, if you are typing this, you will read it as b to the power hat. But that is not what it means. It's simply how do you read it? When you read your answer scripts, when you read your answers, you read it as b hat. So simply write it as b hat. Don't give the caret sign because it looks very wrong. Even though they have allowed it to show that the hat is on top of the b, don't give the caret sign. Prefer writing b hat or simply x bar in this form instead of trying to take it to the superscript. Greek letters, very important in the CS2 exams. In some sums, of course, some sums are very heavy on algebra. So in those sums, I would suggest that you use the symbols because, of course, it gets easier to register the symbols and easier for you to check your own work. It looks neater, it looks more concise. But for some sums, for example, or let's say if it's a 2-mark sum. If it's a 2-mark sum, then there is not much algebra or much working involved. In those cases, to save time, instead of using the symbol of the Greek letter, you can write it in words. Let's say theta, phi. And very important, there is a difference. Always make sure there is a capital Greek letter, there's a small Greek letter, just like in the English language. So if, for example, you're writing the CDF of normal distribution, then that one is a capital phi. It is not the small phi, okay? So capital phi, you have to write all the letters in capital. Sometimes what they do is they just make the first letter capital, but I would not recommend this because suppose if I type phi over here, suppose if I type, let's say, delta. Many a times it might happen that the first letter will become capital. So if you are following just the first letter capitalizing rule, in that case, sometimes you might make an error because of this, because of the automation, you might end up with an error. So I always recommend that if you are typing out the letters, then make sure all the letters are capital instead of just the first letter. Another thing, in case you are using the equation editor to type the Greek letters, in this case, you only have to get the first letter capital for getting the capital symbol. See, this is the difference. The first one is the capital phi, so I use the capital P, and the second one is the small phi, so I use the small p along with all other letters small. In the insert tab, how do you get the symbols? Over here, I would strongly suggest making sure all these 20 recently used symbols consist of your Greek letters primarily, because all these less than, equal to, greater than, equal to, these are not that much required. It is more important to have a hold over the Greek symbols in this portion. So one very important thing which I want to show over here is the difference in the two phis, because many a times when we write, we make the differentiation by giving the two lines on top and bottom, right, to make sure it's the capital phi, and in the small phi we don't make the two lines. However, in Word, when you use the symbol from the insert tab, the small phi has a longer line and it's thinner. It's longer and thinner, and the capital phi looks like this. It's fatter, it's a little fatter and a little shorter. Okay, so this difference, make sure you remember, because when you insert, this is how you will have to insert it. You cannot select this and then if you need the capital phi, you cannot go on searching. Make sure you know this difference from the beginning. The other letters also, of course, all the Greek letters are available in the Greek and Coptic section. You can easily find any letter. Make sure if you're using the equation editor also, make sure that you know the names of all the Greek letters that are there in your syllabus, so that when you are trying to use the shortcut for it, you know which word to type to get which letter. In case you all don't know which one, what you can do is, before the exam, make sure you go through this entire list. Here you will find the Greek letter section. So over here, any letter that you need but you do not know the name of, you know how it looks, so you simply search for it. For example, xi. So let's say many of us might be thinking it was epsilon or something. So this is actually xi, and when you move your cursor to it, you can see the name as well as the shortcut that is required for getting that symbol. Okay, so make sure before the exam all this has to be done. Infinity, again, don't go into the hassle of typing the full word, just INF is good enough. For the derivatives, I would suggest use the fx, f dash x, f double dash x method instead of the df by dx, because of course it makes your answer a little concise. However, in some portions, let's say there is a differential equation, then you will feel comfortable using the ddx method. So only in those cases stick to the ddx method. Otherwise, to make your answers short, use the f dash x method. If you're doing a partial differentiation again, so what I would suggest is, for partial differentiation, they say that we can mention it in the bracket that it's partial, but it doesn't look nice to mention it like this. So there are just some sums where you have to actually partially differentiate. So in those sums, I would suggest either you insert the symbol from here, or it will just take a minute, take 2-3 seconds if you are in practice, to press Alt equal to and get the delta sign. Okay, you can just quickly do this for any sum which you know requires partial differentiation or partial anything, if the delta sign is required. I don't like stating partial, but of course, if any of you don't feel comfortable with it, then you can always fall back on this method by mentioning partial in the brackets. Summation, integration, and product. Again, a very important concept. This is there in all the papers. It's a very simple concept. First, you write the function or the operation that you are applying. If it's integration, then you just type int. For sum, you just type sum. And for product, we describe product. Then, of course, there are the limits. So the limits you write inside the first bracket. You just write the limits. You do not have to write I equal to this. You just straight away write the limits. Let's say 1 to infinity. Then you put a colon to show that now you are writing the function on which the operation is being applied. So then you write the function. Make sure your function is inside the brackets. Let's say x squared. Let's say this is the function. Now the dx for the integration. The dx for the integration is also part of the function. Okay, so make sure that the dx also comes inside the bracket. Okay, or what you can do is you can take another bracket over here. Same ditto method, same ditto logic is applied for sum and product also. Okay. All these are fine, not really required for CS2. Chi squared, it's always chi squared full, and then underscore you write the degrees of freedom. Don't mention with m degrees of freedom, takes up a lot of time. Simply just underscore and write the number or the variable, whatever it is. These functions not required in CS2 at all. Choose function, some places you might need it. So I always suggest for choose function, you use this way, the same as you use in your R. It's the same thing. So there is nothing new over here. Just like you use choose and in the bracket, you write the parameters. In the same way, you do it over here also while typing your normal answers. I hope everything up to here is clear. Now we'll just move on to the paper for April 2021. We will try to solve some sums today, and then we'll keep another class where we can solve the rest of the sums. 9 questions. Yes, so in CS2, the standard is 9 to 11 questions usually. 9 to 11 questions. That's what happens for most of the terms. No MCQs have come till date in CS2. No MCQ questions have come in CS2. So I don't think any of you should keep the expectation of meeting any MCQs. Be prepared to type, but definitely the institute will provide some marks for the effort required in typing some questions. For example, some questions that require a lot of algebra, they will have some more marks. For example, in the last class, I had shown you all the Markov jump sum, where the transitional states and the entire likelihood function had to be written. Just the likelihood function, I think, was for 6 marks because it required so much typing. And it actually took up a lot of time in just writing and solving that equation on board. So the first question is a Coppola question. Frank Coppola CF for a bivariate distribution is defined as CF U, V is equal to minus 1 by alpha. So this is just the Frank Coppola thing. Now, one thing you have to get used to.
Ma'am, we haven't done Coppola's yet.
No problem. So I'll just show you the typing aspect and I'll just say some things. It's nothing, no part of the paper. I will show in a way where you have to know the concept. You can just see how to type it. Okay. Yeah. All right. No problem if you haven't done. I'm sure, it's just January till now. So you all do have a lot of time to finish the syllabus as of now. So it's okay if you all haven't done it. I will just show you, it's nothing. You just have to see the typing. Because Coppola is one topic which is a little heavy on the formulas. There are a lot of components in the formula itself. So that is why one very important thing, as I was saying, is you all have to start getting a little used to understanding and registering formulas and expressions in the keyboard notation form. Because April 21 term, they did not do any such thing. But in September 21 term, the question paper itself was in the keyboard notation form. So, for example, some people like me, I am always someone who has tried using equation editor for most of my answers. But when I saw that the question paper has only come in the keyboard notation, then I had to actually sit and try to understand what the question exactly is saying. So that's why a little comfort with the keyboard notation form is very important now. So over here, of course, in this term, they gave the normal formula in the mathematical form. So determine probability that the two jointly random variables x and y are both less than or equal to their median values, where x and y follow Frank Coppola with alpha equal to 1. So I will just show you all the answer to just so that you all know exactly for how many marks, how much you have to write, how many steps you have to show. So it's a 2-mark question. 2-mark question, you can simply give 2 steps maximum. 2 steps is good enough properly explaining. Of course, 1 step has to be the final answer, and maybe 1 step of just the intermediate calculation or just the substitution. You don't have to write the formula necessarily, because over here they have given the formula in the question, right? So in such questions where the formula is given, even in the second one, let's say, the equation is given in the question, even though it is just a very normal MA process, it is given in the question. So you don't have to type it again, and don't try to copy paste it for sure, because copy pasting is not, especially from the question paper or from any outside source, is not accepted by the institutes. Maybe from Excel, definitely Excel R, etc., you can copy paste some answers, but you have to explain those workings again. So don't copy paste the formula if they have given it in the question. Simply substitute the values and show 1 step. Just that 1 step of substitution and 1 step of solving, final answer, that's it. The revised value when alpha equal to 0.1, again 1-mark question, just 1 step required. Determine the probability that the two jointly distributed random variables x and y are both less than or equal to their median values, where x and y follow the product copula. So now, you all don't know, but product copula is a different type of copula. So obviously now here you have to show that it's following a product copula. So you have to add this one line that C is following the product copula. This you have to show in your answer, and you have to write the formula. See, for example, in the first step, they did not write the formula, right? They simply substituted the values. Over here, they're talking about a new copula. So now you have to write the formula as well. Comment on your answers. Commenting, you all have to take care. It's just simply typing. Make sure some tips that in commenting, whenever there is a commenting question or a comparing question, your first paragraph should always contain the answers. So, like for example, over here, you're comparing the 3 parts answers. So first you mention that this is the answer we got in part one, this is we got the answer in part two, and this is the answer for part three. And then in the next paragraph, you start explaining what it signifies. So you know it takes up a lot of it takes up certain amount of words also for your answer, and it also makes it clear for the examiner to have everything in one place. Moving on to the second question. A second order moving average process is defined by the following equation. This is a standard MA2 process, where ET is a white noise process with variance sigma square. Determine expectation of XT and variance of XT. As you all know, time series is definitely one topic where a lot of typing will be involved, and you cannot escape it. They will not give you and cut you any slack for time series question. They will make you type everything. So time series, definitely practice a lot. Make sure you practice a lot of questions from time series so that you can get used to it. You can work out for yourself some shortcuts, whatever suits you. If copy pasting suits you, because of course there are some symbols that are easier to copy paste, and because they are very repetitive, so you have to practice a lot of sums for time series specifically. So expectation of XT, you have to write everything. This is how many marks? 3 marks. So yes, a good 3-4 steps is minimum required for this question. Mu plus, now this expectation of E underscore T, you can write DT also, but because over here there is the concept of T minus 1, T minus 2 also, you can give an underscore as well, because of course this differentiates it a little. If you're writing ET minus 1 or ET minus 2, and it's not looking right, it's looking ET is different and minus 1 is different. What you may do is give a bracket maybe, then it's fine. But of course, in these cases, it's always better that you give the underscore. And over here, they haven't used the bracket after the underscore, but I would suggest that you all keep in practice of using a bracket as well. For this, for the underscore portion, use a separate bracket so that it's clearer for you also when you check, when you're done with the paper, let's say, and you're checking, then you will know that it's a separate thing. While typing, maybe it feels that meko to pata hai ki this means ET minus 1. But while checking, maybe you will realize how did the minus 1 come, because you might think it's separate from the ET. So for mu is a small letter. Even if you go on typing it, it's fine instead of giving the symbol. But for the bigger letters, the words which are bigger, it's better to use the symbol. For example, if there is a beta, let's say. Once you take a beta, you just insert it from the insert tab, or you might use the equation editor immediately and get a beta. Either thing you can do, and then you just copy paste it every line. For every line, you just go on copy pasting it. You keep that beta copied on your keyboard, and every time a beta comes, you just press Control V. Okay, instead of typing beta, you type Control V. So your beta symbol comes. So it makes your answer concise, easier to check, easier to read, and easier to understand. After that, determine the autocovariance function. Again, very heavy on algebra, and it's for 4 marks. So, as you can see, it's quite a long answer. Time series is definitely something you'll have to practice only. There is no way of making it shorter, because it's anyway a long sum. But one very important thing, while typing, don't forget that you also have to explain. Every step that you are doing, every conclusion that you are making, make sure you mention it in your answer. As covariances of all other cross-multiplied terms are zero. So for example, when we find out the covariances, when you find out the covariances, there are many two constant terms, or let's say two independent error terms, etc. So in those cases, the covariance becomes zero. You cannot straight away write a zero. You have to mention in a bracket, at the same line, on the next line itself, why you are writing a zero in place of those covariances, okay? So here, they have just written covariances of all other cross-multiplied terms are zero, but what is expected of you? This is the examiner's report. You have to mention the reason as well. Why is it zero? Either it is independent error terms, or it is two constants, or it is two unrelated variables. Every reason has to be mentioned as well. Okay, so don't just think that because the ER says this. No, you have to mention the reason as well. Number 3, consider the following stochastic process. Yt is equal to x1 plus x2 dot 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 xt, where t is 1, 2, 3, and xi are random variables that are IITs, as normal 0, comma sigma square. Explain whether Yt is a Markov process, a very, very, very common question in the CS2 paper. So this, you have to remember what all points have to be true for any process to be a Markov process. How do you write this answer? These answers are very crisp points. So it's always better that you make sure your points are in different lines, because when you give points in different lines instead of giving a paragraph answer, it shows that you are confident about each and every point. You know exactly what is required in the answer. Because when we tend to write a paragraph, We usually do it because we are unsure of what all we want to write. We want to include many things together. But when you're very sure, you will make sure you're highlighting keywords. You are writing it in separate lines. So I would suggest such answers, you write it in bullet form. Bullets can easily be inserted from the home tab. Over here, you have all the bullets. No need to decorate your paper. Use the simple bullet, either this one or the arrow one. Otherwise, if not the bullets, you all can just write, let's say, answer 3, part 1, and then I'll just see the answer from. Over here, and the way they have written it in point, separate lines, you also use separate lines. So I'll show you this answer has independent increments. XI, as I had said, it's not necessary that you give the underscore in this case. So you can simply write XI are independent. Now, why I showed you this typing? Because as soon as you will press enter to go to the next line, you will get the part 2 again. So how do you undo this? Just press enter again or just press backspace. If you press enter, what will happen? Your alignment will change. Your indentation will go more towards the left. If you press backspace, your indentation won't change. So that's why if you want to continue in the same paragraph, you use backspace. If you want to move to the next paragraph and you want to change your indentation, then you press enter. Okay? So we just do this again, backspace. Next point is here there is mainly just these 2 points. So you can just keep this in the next line. In all theory answers, in all comments, all suggestions, make sure you are highlighting the keywords. For highlighting, I don't know if I'd mentioned in the CS2 class or not, don't use underlining, don't use italics, always use a bold method. So because the italics, it might get confused with your equation editor areas, and the underline might get hidden by the red lines for the proofreading. Okay, so it's always better you make it bold, because that's the one way which is always visible. Don't add any color, especially not red. In fact, don't use any color. Just make sure your entire answer script is black. Okay, so just bold is enough for highlighting keywords. Derive an expression in terms of t for the value of the correlation coefficient, simplifying your answer as far as possible. So of course, it's a derivation question, so it's for 5 marks, which means there is a lot of typing. There is this much of typing for 5 marks. Definitely for 5 marks, it will take up nearly half a page of your MS Word file. Okay. So how do we do this in a quicker manner? You use copy paste as much as possible. For example, you can copy paste this thing. Because this thing, if you are typing again and again, so for example, over here, it's correlation of this, then it is covariance of this. Then again, in the final answer, you'll again have to mention it. So you can copy paste this, because these are a considerable amount of characters. Again, sigma squared is something that you can keep copied on your keyboard and go on pasting sigma squared at every step. X underscore t, because over here, of course, there's t plus one concept. So you'll be using x underscore t. Even this is something that you can keep copied, but I would suggest it's not required because every time anyway you'll have to change it. You'll have to change the T to either 1 or T plus something. So this one not required. Definitely this thing, I would say copy it. Sigma square, copy it. Okay. Again, the explanation lines, they are showing half mark over here. This is actually for explaining. Okay. So every step, make sure you are explaining it. Part 3 is a comment so that you all can see later. Number 4, a duration dependent Markov jump process model is constructed to model the recovery and mortality rates of individuals who are sick with a particular medical condition. The model includes the following 3 states, sick, recovered, and dead. Under this model, an individual who has been sick for duration T experiences a transition rate, Okay, so the transition rates are here. A, B, and C are parameters greater than 0 that depend on the characteristics of the individual. Comment on the reasonableness. Let's see. So many points just for 2 marks, any 4-5 points. So usually when there is a 2 mark commenting for which requires, which is a point form answer, usually they are expecting minimum 4 marks, minimum 4 points. So to be on the safe side, definitely write around 5 points when you have the ability to write the 5 points. Like when you can think of 5 points, definitely go for 5 points. They are not mentioning how many points, so there will be no penalization for writing extra points. As many points as you can think of, just write those points. Okay. The second part is for 7 marks and it requires considerable typing. Demonstrate that the probability that an individual who has just become sick eventually recovers is this. So of course, the transition rates, once you type the transition rates, then you start copy pasting it in this question. Over here, there is an integration. So again, how do we do the integration? INT 0, comma infinity. This INF is fine. Then you write the function. So over here, first you're explaining what you're doing. So probability that remains in 6 state from t equal to 0 to t into the transition rate. And then you write. After that, the integration. Here you can copy paste the integration along with this. So, for example, if I was typing this answer, let's say I'm starting from this portion after the therefore. So, I type integration 0 to infinity. Exponential minus a plus c what I will do is for the next step again I have to do an integration so now I will copy it now I will copy it paste it over here there's an adjustment in the exponential. So I will simply add to this exponential. Okay, the first exponential, I will add the a. Okay. And then the rest of it, we just select it. Minus a plus b. Solving it. Now, this is how you write for the limits after you have solved the integral. After you have solved the integral, you have to add the limits to the box brackets. So how do you do that? You write whatever function is required inside the box bracket. So if I copy paste it from the format. So you copy paste it. And then in the first brackets, you write the limits. Or if you're, let's say, suppose if you're doing this answer in the equation editor, how do we do this? The integration sign is simply int again. Now, very important, in the equation editor, when you want to add limits to your operators, you first give the lower limit using an underscore. Then you give the upper limit using the caret sign. And after that, you press the space. Don't press the space after giving any one limit, because if you, let's say, I'll just show it to you once. We'll show you what happens if you press the space beforehand. Okay, I press the space thinking that I've given the lower limit. Now my chance of giving the upper limit is gone. No matter how much I try, it will not go on top of the integral set. Okay. So always remember this if you are using the equation editor, that for adding the upper and lower limits, add them together and only after that press the space bar for them to take position. Don't press it in the middle at all. If you do it, you'll have to redo the entire thing, redo the entire integral. So it's always better that you keep this in practice. Clear? So as you can see, this is such a small answer. It was maximum 3 steps answer. Still, they gave 7 marks because of this typing. Because of the amount of typing that was involved, they gave this for 7 marks. Number 5, we'll stop at 5 today. We'll just do number 5 now. The rest of the question we'll do in the next class. A life insurance company has offices in towns A and B. Company writes 25-year term assurance policies. Below are data from the two offices related to policyholders of the same age X. Policies in force and deaths are on an age last birthday basis. The table is given. Estimate the force of mortality for calendar year 2020 in respect of each of the offices in towns A and B. Okay. So, what do we do? It's for 2 marks. We have to calculate 2 values. And now the sum clearly said estimate, which means we have to show the calculation, correct? So you just show one step calculation. Of course, just one step is more than enough. No formula is required in this case. You show the one step and then write the force of mortality for both. Okay. A detailed examination of the records shows that 50% of the policies are in force in town A at both dates were in respect of smokers, and 20% policies in force in town B at both dates were in respect of smokers. National forces of mortality at age X for smokers in 2020 were 50% higher than those for non-smokers. Estimate the force of mortality for smokers and for non-smokers in each of the towns A and B, clearly stating any assumptions that you make. Get. Very important over here. They have said it also in the answer. Every step that you are making an assumption or you are concluding something because of any reason, you have to mention it in the sum itself. So, assumptions, of course, the basic assumptions, all of you must be knowing after doing the chapter, that the basic assumptions remain the same. So that you have to write in the beginning of the question, okay? Now over here, I think they had 2 methods of giving the answer. They had 2 alternative solutions because this sum was actually a very tricky sum in some aspects. So they gave 2 alternate solutions. Let's see any one. Let the force of mortality for smokers in town A be mu SA and that for non-smokers be mu NA. We therefore have, and then the entire equation solving is done. So this question was for 6 marks. So a good 4 steps minimum four steps to five steps minimum have to be shown, correct? So over here, first you show for town A and then for town B. For town B, what you can do is you can copy paste the solution for town A and just change the values, right? That is very doable because the method remains the same. The only thing that's changing is the values, the different mortalities, and all the A's will become B, correct? So you can simply copy paste. And what I would suggest in such questions, your calculation, if you do not feel comfortable enough, you can quickly take a pen and paper and do it on paper, because that way you do tend to get a little more confident about your answer once you've written it. So that's why in such questions, you can consider keeping a blank paper, or definitely keep a blank paper during your exams, because some questions will require you to write it and then type it. So suppose if you write this, then you will know exactly where to make the edits. When you copy paste it from A to B, you will know exactly which places require changes, correct? So that's that. Part 3 is again a comment. So this comment is for 3 marks, so definitely 6 points. So marks available 7, maximum 3. So there are so many points, you have to give any 6, because usually the points that we normally tend to think are the half mark points. These 1 mark points are very rarely the ones that come to our mind in the exam. So that's why you have to go write your answer with the concept that every point is for half a mark. So give a minimum of 6 points. Again, when you are giving these points, make sure you're doing it in a point form method. Either you use separate lines or you use bullets. Either way is fine. But don't avoid writing paragraphs in your answer scripts, because as I said, it shows more confidence. Okay. So today we'll be stopping here. Do any of you have any questions regarding whatever questions we discussed today, whatever typing aspects we discussed? Anything? Anything in particular that you all want me to discuss or make you all practice something? Nothing. So then, okay, you all can leave the class. Thank you so much.